We have a very interesting panel discussion on connected fleet telematics, which is going to be moderated by Mr. Varun Madhusudhanan, who's the senior manager at Deloitte. He's part of the University of Warwick and B in mechanical engineering from MS Ramaya. Varun, the stage, the panel, and the subject is all yours. Thank you.
Right. Good evening to everybody. My name is Varun, as Arjun introduced. I've been in Deloitte for about 12 years, sorry, 1 year, but professional services for about 12 years now. So I form part of Deloitte Consulting, and within that, closely work with the Deloitte Digital team as well. One of the interested areas or focus areas of Deloitte has been in the space of digitization amongst different processes within organization, and second, you know, the growing trends towards telematics in the wider automotive industry itself. For the purpose of this session, what we kind of narrowed down our topic with my fellow panelists was to do with the commercial vehicle telematics space. Quick thing, so from our perspective, I think there are three things that's predominantly given thrust to commercial vehicle telematics, although in its very, very nascent stage. The first, of course, is, as everyone would be aware, is around the government incentives. You know, your any MMPs, your FAME, your regulations around employee security within the corporate sector, and so on and so forth. Second is largely on the recognition of you know, the end users for the need of end-to-end supply chain support, and third, of course, the penetration within the OEMs itself, right? And with this has also come a multitude of software or technology companies to aid in this entire effort. In the panel today, we have a fair mix of representation of connected services from the OEMs and also from the software technology side of things. Quick introduction, and I'd invite them onto the stage. First up is Jagdish Nagraj, who's a business consultant with Volvo Group Connected Services. Jagdish. Second is Matiur Rahaman, from who's an associate director, IoT cloud software of Tata Communications. Third, we have Anandha Raghavan, who's the head of connected services for SCANIA. And lastly, Prakash Channagiri of iTriangle. He's a director with software services within the company. A hearty welcome to all the panelists. Right, so we have a set of questions, you know, planned out for the panelists. And the intent largely was for us to kind of explore, you know, some of the learnings that they've had through their prior experience, some of them being early entrants into the commercial vehicle space telematics market. And second is the convergence opportunities that exist across the commercial sector, right? So that's largely the theme of questions that we had intended for this particular session. We'll have a Q&A session with the panelists for about 30 minutes, and I'll open it up to the audience for maybe what, 10, 15 minutes for any other questions that you might have. First up, a question to you, Jagdish. So what I understand is, I mean, of course, Volvo has been in the market for 20 years, and you've been early entrants into the commercial vehicle space market. So how, in your opinion, in your company's opinion, is your telematics solution changing the Indian context, what those services are meant for?
Well, briefly, first of all, in a role as a business consultant in Volvo Group Connected Solutions, I get insights into the solutions we develop, as well as the needs that our business units take a look at from an external perspective. So the business units are trucks, construction equipment, buses, in that sense. So if I had to kind of summarize on that question, is we have a variety of solutions. There's a solution called Dynafleet, which is focused on the EMEA market, on the premium brand, the Volvo trucks. We have Volvo trucks in India too, on which we have Dynafleet. Then we have a set of solutions for the UD trucks that we sell in Japan and internationally. In context of India, in collaboration with our joint venture partner, Aisha, there's a solution called Aisha Live. So if I had to put it in a way, it's kind of segmented as to how these solutions operate, kind of apply to different markets. A solution like iShellI would have things like track and trace. It would address certain things specific to uptime. It would address certain things related to fuel efficiency in terms of tracking that. A solution like Dynafleet, which is EMEA-based, would have additional features where things like driver behavior or aspects related to safety, security, those kind of features would be there in those kind of markets. So it's kind of a segmented approach on how we develop these solutions for the markets. But in terms of how the teams contribute, we are a global team. So you could have needs from different markets, and obviously you can't just fix the solution for all markets. So it goes through a pipeline where there's someone governing the product roadmap orally, and then it comes into a backlog, and then it's appropriately put into the made available to the appropriate markets, and they have the discretion of choosing whether they need to roll it out now or roll it out later. So that's how we work, essentially.
Right. Thank you, Nagraj. Matiur, from your New York company's perspective, the Indian telecommunications sector is undergoing seismic changes, especially with concerns to onboard devices, right? And I just draw reference from some other developing markets and specifically from my experience with the South African market. The connectivity is still largely, the core of it seems to be on 2G connectivity, right? So what is Tata Communications doing from a backbone point of view, and what, in your opinion, what role does a narrowband IoT play in the entire connectivity space?
Okay, thank you. So to my mind, the question is around the change in the connectivity space,
yeah.
Right? And the narrowband IoT and other adjacent technologies, and what's their role going to be? So look, Before you get into the connectivity space, you have to understand what kind of applications that somebody would like to build. Ultimately, applications would decide, what kind of connectivity that I have to choose for, So there are three things that a telco or a solution provider should typically look for. One is what should be my technical model, what should be my commercial model, and what should be my deployment model. Now, if you look at the technical model, both NB-IoT or any other technology like LPWAN or LoRa that we are promoting would fall under the sub-gigahertz band. But what happens is, in NB-IoT, you get low latency. You can throughput a lot of data payload is higher, and you get quality of service, right? But if you change it to an LPWAN or a LoRa kind of scenario, okay, you do not have low latency. The latency could be slightly higher, and the payload could be optimized. You're not able to push data in seconds, so you have an optimized payload. But then you do the trade-off between extended battery life. You save a lot of battery on the device. The other way of looking at this is, one is it has to run on 4G LTE, so you have to have minimum 4G LTE to run NB-IoT, and hence that just becomes part of a regulated band, and you have to pay spectrum and things like that, which is not the case for LPWAN. Now, if you come back to the commercial model, so in commercials also, somebody has to think of two things. One is, what is the cost of building that network, and what is the cost of building a device? And remember, everything will be passed on to the customer. So if today I have to have a 4G base station to support an NB-IoT device, it has to get upgraded, and then upgrade cost to my mind, to my understanding, is about $8,000 to $10,000 per base stations. So if somebody trying to upgrade hundreds of thousands of base stations to support NB-IoT, and that cost is going to be passed on to the customer, that's one. Second, on NB-IoT, if you look at, because the modulation and protocol is so complex, it needs more silicon space. Means the device price will be higher. The module price that's going to come up will be higher because the silicon is like that. That's not the case with LPWAN. So LPWAN is much mature. Today we are talking about modules coming in the range of $6 to $7. So the cost advantage is then passed on to the customer, right? So that's the trade-off that you do. Okay, I'm fine with little higher latency, I'm fine with optimized payload, I get higher battery and then I save on cost. Then comes the deployment model. In case of 4G LTE or which support, which is mandatory for you to kind of roll out NB-IoT applications, in deployment model, you have to depend on that. So you are basically constrained by a public network, right? And we all understand then the situation around network connectivity in India, right? Even in this room, most of us may not get 4G. But if you look at LPWAN, what we can do is we can bring in hybrid option also for enterprise. Means we are rolling out a public network, which is LPWAN network. We're covering about 40 cities. We're expanding in other cities. But then if a truck has to move out from a warehouse in Peenya and then it has to go to the other side, even if I don't have network inside that warehouse, I can augment network and hence give a hybrid kind of a solution offering to an enterprise, to a customer. So these are three things: technicalities, deployment model, commercials. You'll have to look at before a telco decides on which technology, which is NB-IoT or something else. So coming back to my initial thought that both will have, I think, play in the market because there are different kind of application requirements, right? So yeah, both will have their space in the market.
Thank you. Anand, the next one's to you. So SCANIA is heavily invested in digitizing its telematics platform, SCANIA One, which is quite popular in Europe. Now, if you look at it from an Indian context, especially with the education levels of drivers and fleet operators and the like, what is SCANIA doing differently to cater to the Indian market?
Thank you. Just a quick note on the question. So SCANIA's telematics platform was always digital even before SCANIA One. But what essentially SCANIA One does is assemble all the SCANIA's digital offering in one entry module. So and also there is an additional flexibility for the development of applications from third-party developers. So SCANIA recognizes the value of being modular in terms of its value offerings. So we have given a certain way room for third-party developers to integrate with SCANIA through SCANIA One.
And these are essentially in the spaces of fleet management, financial services, driver.
Absolutely. Yeah, and on top of it, they also, if you look at SCANIA One per se, there are three basic core services. One is SCANIA Core Offerings, which is the list that you have mentioned. And there are also local market-oriented applications developed by the distributors. And if you take the third layer, that would be the third-party app developers.
Sure.
So if they are interested, they can always collaborate with SCANIA and develop an app which they feel would add more value to a SCANIA user. Coming to the question of what we do in India to digitize our telematics. Essentially what we are doing is not, we are doing when we collaborate with the customers. We do both sort of backward and forward integration of their business through our telematics. By that I mean, if you look at the existing Indian customers, be it mining or bus customers, most of the record keeping happens either in a notebook or in a spreadsheet. So what essentially SCANIA Fleet Management does is it integrates the data that they keep in spreadsheets or notebooks back into a web portal which is accessible to them at a click of a button. And what I mean when I say forward integration is when a customer looks for avenues to grow, say for example a bus customer wants to survey a new route, so we support the customer through the data that is available in SCANIA Fleet Management app. So that sort of digitizes their business more than what we bring to our digitization. Because SCANIA One as a concept is still being in a nascent stage in different markets, which is even at a developed stage. So looking at SCANIA One as a solution for India might be too early. So essentially what we are trying to do is digitizing the customer business and make them ready for when we launch SCANIA One.
So does it mean that the option available to the end customer is heavily modular in nature, and he can pick and choose the services that is most valuable to him and customize it for his business needs? Is that essentially
Absolutely.
What you're saying?
That's when SCANIA One launches. But right, what we in India are doing essentially right now is preparing the playground for when we come in with the big guns.
Right. So. Right. All right, thank you.
Prakash. Prakash, you've had multiple use cases in the market. You've been working and you've been deployed. You've deployed your solutions with Uber Leasing, IOCL, governments in Karnataka, and Manipur. So in your opinion, of the number of jobs that you've delivered to your end customers of such, what in your opinion are these long-term sustained benefits, both from a private sector and from a public sector point of view?
Sure. So quick introduction. So iTriangle has been in business for the last 9 years. And I say that only to give a context of a background to what I'm talking. So we have been in the business for 9 years, and we are manufacturers of GPS vehicle tracking devices. And the first couple of years were spent solely on product development. And then at around the same time, we saw traction in the taxi aggregator, taxi cab sector, primarily because of the ugly incidents that happened in Delhi a few years ago. So it started from, and I'm talking specifically about the non-government sector, the private sector. So it started primarily from a safety and security standpoint, right? And on the government side, there was mandate to have these devices installed. And even though the devices were installed specifically for the purpose of productivity and efficiency, the experience has been not that fast, I would say. People still do not know about the product and in what ways it can bring about productivity and efficiency. But what we did notice was that over time, they began to see the benefits of it. On the private side, basically we have, if you were to categorize the sector, right? Anybody who owns even a single vehicle is potentially our customer. But so far, which would be the B2C segment, but if you look at B2B, which is where we have concentrated on and which is where we saw the traction early on, anybody who owns a fleet of vehicles is potentially our customer. And that opens up, I mean, it's just unimaginable how many, any business practically has to have vehicles. So it just opens up a wide range of opportunities. And in that, if I were to get a little more specific, we usually categorize it based on the vertical. So for example, transportation and logistics is one. Employee transport management is another. Schools is another. Mining is another, so on and so forth.
Understand the personas that are associated with this, both on, say, the customer side as well as on the dealer side, and maybe internally too within the company, then you have better perspective of the right points to prioritize or the opportunities where connected services can help. So that's been an effort that's been our focus for the last few years, even more intensely, to take a more closer look at the customer journey. Having said that, aspects like, does your organization structure support selling connected services in a good way? Is there a traditional mindset that flows within the organization structure? From a dealer perspective, how much change management needs to be done in order to explain the value of that service rather than just looking at the price? Same thing at the dealerships. The dealership tends to be the customers for the OEM because they then sell the stuff to the end customers. So there are things that need to be done probably also in an organization structure, change management, and of course business model, these aspects. But the way we are looking at it now is the customer journey a bit more intensely and other aspects than just directly going at, I think the customer needs this, so let's make an announcement in the solution, and then later you find out it won't sell or it was not used. So that's the change.
Sorry, would there be any specific use cases here of how you map these personas and what has been your findings based on the different personas that you found out either on a fleet operator side or the end?
Well, maybe take too much time there, but then on the customer side, we actually noticed there are some 10, 11 personas, and people tend to just say, okay, we need to develop for the end customer. But if you dig a bit deeper, then someone might know one or two customer personas. Not, it'll talk about the fleet owner and the driver. But there are probably other aspects to it on roles that get, part of the process where they're actually using the connected services. Similarly, on the dealer side, there are almost, there also around 10, 12 personas that we are aware of. Those are the examples in which you take it, and then you take it from a perspective of journey and identify the pain points, say for uptime, what typically happens in an uptime process, what are the things that you're addressing through your current solutions, what are the ones that you could do more. Of course, you would take in competition perspective also when you're doing that exercise, what's already being provided, and what can you do as a differentiator. So a multitude of things.
Sure. Thanks, Jagdish. Matiur, now, and this is a quote from one of my public findings, right? A rollout of 50 million IoT devices by 2022. That's the plan for Tata Communications. And what I understand is this is essentially towards improving asset management, your energy management, and customer feedback processes. Now, I also understand that from an IoT and connected telematics point of view, there had also been experiences from other countries in South Asia. Now, what is Tata Communications' plan to adopt some of these experiences from other Asian markets and actually make it more relevant for the, from an Indian context?
Okay, so there are a couple of points here. One is this 50 million devices by 2022. That's an aspirational number, and I think we are heading towards the right direction.
But it's good to be calling out those aspirational numbers.
Yeah, aspirational number, and we are on track. We're very much on track. We're heading towards that. And you rightly mentioned, and this is not only going to come from telematics as a vertical. It's going to come from asset management, utilities. We are betting big on safety. I think you have not mentioned about safety around women safety and worker safety, you know, people working in hazardous conditions and things like that. And in all these verticals, we have seen a great traction with enterprises, whomever we've interacted with, and all these vertical solutions are implemented. We put a couple of them in display in our booth as well. So that's one. So that's the 50 million part of it. Now, if we get to the telematics, if you try to relate, you know, if you go a little deep into telematics, so we look at telematics from an asset management or an asset tracking lens. So like Prakash mentioned, just by able to track and trace itself gives you a lot of value, you know, and today the entire tracking system works on GSM. I'm just going back to my earlier point. So we are looking at it from asset management lens, as in vehicle, as an asset. Do you want to track it independent of your telematics device? You know, if somebody switch off the telematics device, the SIM card is not working, somebody removes it purposefully, what if I give you a device which can still give you the location of the vehicle? What if it can tell you which direction it is moving and things like that? The AIS 140 again adds to it. That will again add to our 50 million thing, is that they made it that every commercial or public vehicle has to have a tracker device, has to have a panic button, right? Yeah. Now, if we have to put a panic button inside a device, inside a vehicle, would you want that to be physically connected to the vehicle? What if I give you a battery-operated device, just plug and play, and you have a panic situation, somebody pushes it? And again, it doesn't depend on the existing network that the vehicle is using. It's an independent network, and I give you a certain SLA, and you know, the data is picked up. You know, other way of looking at telematics is, so you're looking at the adjacent things. You're not touching the telematics device at all, whatever is fitted, right? I'm talking about an independent tracker device, an independently operated button device. There are a lot of talks around these electric vehicles and stuff that are going, and a lot of push from the government also, right? In a decade's time, all of us are going to move to electric mobility. So that's going to open a new stream of opportunities and hence new stream of business models, right? Somebody will make batteries, somebody will put charging stations, somebody will offer batteries as a service and things like that. Now, if I look at battery as an asset, which is sitting inside the vehicle, and what if I say, okay, I can give you 5 critical parameters twice a day on my network, again, independent of it, right? So what all of it means is for telematics solution providers or solution builder is that there are a lot of alternate technologies that are opening up for you to choose from when you build your solution, right? Yeah. So that's what I'm seeing is benefiting the entire ecosystem, I mean, in this room. Getting back to the learning, taking learning from other markets. Look, for LPON, we are completely focused in the India market and very, very committed in India. And the numbers that we are projecting is from India. You know, But definitely we'll take learnings from our group companies. You know, we have TCS and other companies who are global in nature. We will take learnings from them, what's getting implemented outside, and we will see if that is relevant for the Indian scenario. And we'll definitely take learnings from those.
Sure, but any specific ones already implemented based on learnings from the other South Asian markets? Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand?
Yeah, so we are seeing a lot of traction around child tracking and pet tracking, which we've not been focusing on. We see this is happening in some of the Asian countries, even in Europe. So we are talking to some of our partners in those markets to see how can we get those devices in India, get their devices enabled, and so that they work on our network, and can we offer services like that. So
sure.
Thank you.
Anand, back to you. So SCANIA has been, one of the buzzwords within SCANIA seems to be sustainability. And one of the recent things that is making news, obviously, is sustainability within your public transportation sector. Could you maybe elaborate on that a little to say what SCANIA is doing from a sustainability point of view within public transportation? And what other alternative sustainability initiatives has already been taken up by SCANIA?
To answer your first question in terms of sustainability for public transports, so in SCANIA, we apply sustainability to everything we offer to customers, be it vehicles or be it services. So I can give you a brief understanding of what we mean by sustainability with respect to vehicles, and I will go in detail about what we mean by sustainability for services. So when it comes to vehicles, we see sustainability from the perspective of using alternative fuels. That is one way in which we can live up to the word sustainability. So for example, we have run a project with Nagpur Municipal Corporation and operated buses on ethanol as a fuel. So that is one of the way in which we live up to our buzzword sustainability when it comes to vehicles. But services, on services, when we say sustainability, we essentially mean two things. One is productivity, another is elimination of waste. Even though at the very quick glance it can appear as two sides of the same coin, essentially it is not. It is two very different things. So what do I mean by that? When I say productivity, if you look at the fleet utilization across the SCANIA vehicle owners, be it high-end buses or mining tippers, they vary anywhere between 50 and 70%. Which is astonishingly low, considering the asset value. So we still need to suggest to the customers about improving the fleet utilization. So that is what we mean by sustainability. And what we invariably do is we use data and we transform the way the customer conducts his business. I'll give an example in mining. So we have engaged with a customer to increase the throughput of his mines. So what we essentially did was we did a site study and we analyzed and we understood the potential area for improvement. And we also went back in and we analyzed what we can do with what we know. Say for example, we have a certain set of philosophies that we apply to when it comes to our manufacturing line, SCANIA production system. So we essentially married what we did with SCANIA production system with the data that we have from the mining customers. And the results were excellent. The customer finished the project well in advance. You can take this in two ways. One is the customer could have purchased lesser number of vehicles, or customer could have improved his operations. Either way, it is improving the sustainability of customer operations. And secondly, when I say elimination of waste, there is a huge scope of improvement when it comes to upskilling the drivers. So not all the drivers drive the buses or the trucks in a most optimal way. So what we essentially do is we engage with the customers and we offer services that can upskill the drivers, essentially enabling them to conserve fuel. So that essentially is sustainable not only to the customer but to the environment in itself. Because we are doing the same amount of work, but burning less fuel, emitting less carbon dioxide and nitrous oxides, and et cetera, et cetera. So this is what we bring to the table when we talk about sustainability in terms of services?
I take it there are structured programs around
of
these. Okay, thank you. The last question. So iTriangle is looking at being end-to-end solutions provider, I understand, from fleet management, onboard devices, tracking, healthcare devices, and plenty more, right? But at the end of it all of these convergence of technologies and specifics, of the customer demands within each of these solutions that you're offering, it all converges back into data and intelligence. So how is iTriangle kind of enabling that intelligence, and how is it giving back to the customers?
So when we look at the telematics device sector, right, basically there are three venues for revenue. One is selling the hardware device itself, another one is selling the software application, and third one, of course, is the data. Now, when we talk about data, we broadly falls into two buckets. One is vehicle data, and another one is location data, so tracking data. So when we look at tracking data, so it's lat long and other things. If you have an accelerometer, the X, Y, Z coordinates from that. These will be primarily used for building the core features of any telematics solution, such as trip management, route management, trip planning, geofence violations, notifications and alerts, reports, all those things. The more interesting part would be the vehicle data itself. And if you have a telematics device that can connect to an OBD port, onboard diagnostics port, then you can get a lot more information about the vehicle. The ones that are that have been mandated parameters, you can definitely get a lot more information from that. That would be things like, is the window open or not? How hard was the brake press? Things like that. And this sort of data, we again use it to build a little more advanced features such as driver behavior, vehicle diagnostics, and things like that. But I just want to make one point here. So data can be used in two ways, and it all goes back to the application that you're building. So if you're planning to use data in, if you want to do data analytics, data mining, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and whatnot, then you have to have your use cases ready so that you can build the entire architecture such that it matches the, such that it will fulfill the requirements of your use case, right? The more interesting, and needless to say, the more, a lot more interesting thing is to build a platform for your clients, for them to mine the data, right? So rather than you building features for your client, you can build a platform that will enable your clients to build the models that they want, right? So for example, the needs of an insurance sector, if they want to go into the usage-based insurance and things like that, the model required would be dramatically different from another use case. So so we are doing both. We are mining the data and building features on our own, in our own application. But at the same time, we're also building a platform for all our clients so that they can, they also have access to the data and they can use it as they see fit. The tricky part, of course, is always the contractual obligation, the legal agreements that you have with your clients, and whether data can be shared or not, right? So if that's always a tricky thing. And needless to say, you'll find both varieties of clients. Some of them want to keep the data on their own servers and do their own mining and do their own modeling, whereas a good number of people really don't care. And but it is really, really valuable. So and iTriangle being one of the few companies which have a lot of vehicles moving in and around India with this thing, devices attached to them, we are getting a lot of data. What can we do with this data is really interesting, and right now you can do a bunch of crazy things, like we can build a map of all the potholes in Bangalore, right? So, or all the bumps and humps in Bangalore. Where exactly will that be used? We don't know, because it's still very, very, very nascent. But you could think of scenarios like a autonomous driving car or a self-driving car, right? And if it has this sort of information built into it, then it becomes much, much more smarter, right? And safer as well. So both for our own use case and building a platform for our clients is what we are doing with the data that we are acquiring.
Just one more follow-on question to that. So obviously you're building use cases for your customers and developing solutions for your customers, collecting data based on solutions offered. And there are a number of players who are doing that in the market. But ultimately, where is the convergence of all of this intelligence coming to? And what is it going to influence? Is it going to influence policy making? Is it going to influence certain societal decisions? I mean, where do you, from your perspective, and probably this is an open question to the panel as well.
Sure.
You know, so where are we ultimately going with convergence of all this
sure.
data?
I'll just take the first dig at the question. So a lot of this is clearly unknown. And I would say that we are just barely scratching the surface of what's to come. And I'm fairly certain that it will have implications across everything that we are doing. Legislation, security, our business models themselves, right? And our channels. It's going to be dramatically different from what it is today. And many of these things are not sorted out yet. In fact, like even the AIS 140 spec, after much, much, much debate and discussion, it was ratified only recently. And even now, we are still making changes and amends to it. It's expected to happen. But many of these things, I think, will become more clear as we proceed along in terms of data and convergence. Just one more point on that. Where we have had a little bit of success is primarily in being an end-to-end solution provider, in the sense that, you have to understand that most of our clients are not technology people. They are in a different business altogether. And what we are doing is to help them do better in their own business. So so from that point, I mean, like the onus, providing an end-to-end solution in terms of hardware, software, and everything, and installation service has really helped us. That is what I think is crucial as we move along. But as the industry matures, I think we'll see a lot more use cases and a lot more business models coming up. Yeah. But in terms of what ramifications data will have, I think it's my personal opinion that we have to wait and see.
Sure. Any other perspectives from the panel?
So me personally, I think as we move towards this new stretch of technology, I see it as an open field, and I can perfectly imagine there not being a convergence. They can all be parallel. They can all exist within their own ecosystem. It's perfectly plausible that there need not be a point where it can all converge. So that's where I stand right now.
Alternative perspective. Right. Any questions from the audience? Happy to take one or two. There's one.
Hi, this is Saurabh, and I'm really building on the convergence question which the moderator had. So at the dais, we've got two auto OEMs, we got a device manufacturer.
Sure.
And we are all competing for the same data, isn't it? And trying to figure out ways how we can, what we can do with it. Outside the hall, there are several displays. Every second stall talks about the same. There are several established players who have already sold upwards of, say, 100,000 units. And there would be, you know, tons of startups trying to aim for the same. Pinpointed question, where does it all converge to? And in the previous presentation, somebody alluded to OEMs owning the brand experience, right?
Yes.
So what's the panel's thought process on that?
Is it directed at any one of them, or is it an open question? Would anyone want to take a dig at that?
Well, I don't know if it's an answer specifically, but I think we do a lot of stuff, but we need to remember that from a stakeholder perspective, at least there are three that we always keep track of: the end customer, the dealer, and the OEM itself. So there's a lot of technology and there's a lot of buzzwords and there's a lot of advancements also in many of these areas. But profitable growth is the thing that all the three of them would talk about. So my answer to that simple answer would be convergence will be wherever profitable growth is visible for the stakeholder involved, at least these three. If not, it gets skewed. It's more of jargon at times. But it's very exciting. So we should leverage it in the appropriate way.
So this is not exactly relating to data convergence, but in terms of the question that was asked, we see, broadly categorizing, you can just categorize it into two parts, OEM installed devices and then aftermarket installed devices. And I'm talking purely about telematics devices. Clearly, the future is going to be OEM-driven, this thing. We definitely anticipate that in the next couple of years, most of the vehicles will come pre-fitted with a telematics device. Maybe not in the next couple of years, but in the next, in the coming years. And aftermarket will be what it is. Only bits and pieces. That's definitely going to happen, at least on the consumer side of things. But on the business side of things, like B2B, trucks and others might still not, get on that bandwagon as quickly as vehicles in the consumer space. So there'll still be some play left for aftermarket, but the industry is clearly headed the route of, building this into the vehicle itself and the brands, the OEMs owning the brand experience.
Sure. Any other questions? There's one more there.
Hi.
We can hear you.
Hi. My name is Gautam. I represent a company called Easy Gadi. So my question is from the standpoint of a commercial truck owner. So for the commercial trucks, the fuel is a very key part of day-to-day operations, right? So from the OBD standpoint, what is the data that we could get from the fuel standpoint?
I can answer this. So you're right. So fuel is quite important for the clients and also extremely challenging for the people who are building them. The in fact, we were just, Anand and I were just having a discussion on that. I can just share our experience on this particular front. So Omnicom and others are making fuel sensors. And with one fuel sensor, we had difficulty getting the accurate value of how much fuel is left, because especially if it's parked on an incline up or down, the values are a little bit erroneous. So it requires, generally speaking, it requires two sensors, dual probe sensors, and that makes the solution a little more expensive and even more difficult to install because it requires drilling in the tanks and things like that. Now coming to your specific question, with the OBD parameters itself, you can compute the fuel consumption, but I believe it works only for petrol and not diesel, or the other way around, but it works only for one of the fuel types, not the other one. That's one. The second challenge you'll face is that you will find that the OBD implementation itself dramatically varies from OEM to OEM. So even though the spec says that these are the mandated parameters and you have to, give the correct value when somebody asks for it, you, in practical terms, it might or might not happen. So, and for unmandated parameters, it's definitely OEMs will not be willing to share that information. So unless you know the codes and things like that, or you need to have somebody on your end doing reverse engineering. You change something and see what was the change in the OBD data that you got. It's laborious and time consuming, and and you have to do it for each make and model of the car. But through OBD solution, with one of the mandated legislated parameters, it is possible to compute the fuel consumption, but I'm not sure for which I think Anand knows. I think it's diesel or petrol. I forget, but one of them works and another one doesn't.
So I'm not sure if I can answer that question because I don't know. But to answer the question, not much. There will not be much data which will be available for external plug and play devices. Or even if it is available, it might not be as rigorous or accurate as you can if you have the own the OEM-based telematics sort of a software. But when it since you had asked this question from an operator's perspective and not another startup's perspective, I can answer this, that it shouldn't matter which telematics that operator would buy as long as the data is reliable and accurate. So from an operator's perspective, it can be A, B, C, D, E, F, as long as they prove their reliability or the accuracy in terms of the kind of data they generate or the analysis they provide. So that would be my answer to your question.
I mean, from the policy standpoint, do you have any clear directives in terms of what is the data that could be emanated from the OBD?
Nothing that I am aware of.
Okay.
Thanks. Hi, this is Rahul. I'm from VMware IoT Business Unit. I have a question to Anand. You talked about the fleet management applications which would support the external vendors who use SCANIA trucks, right? It's an amazing alternative for them. But how would you manage a customer who has multiple varieties of trucks and probably not only from SCANIA? That's one part. Second part is, how would you manage the data security? And what about the portability of the data? Because over in time, the data is going to be huge when they have a larger amount of fleet and probably when they are looking at a large geography, especially Indian subcontinent is huge, right? So how would you manage the data security as well as data in rust security as well as in motion security?
If I understand your question, you were asking me about...
It's two-part question. Yeah. First part is about if they have multiple varieties, may not be only SCANIA, maybe something from somebody else. How would you manage that? Because you have to give them a single point of pane of glass to look at the entire fleet, right? And the second part is how do you manage the data in rest security as well as data in motion security, which comes from your truck all the way back to your cloud and bring it back to the customer.
So with respect to your question on mixed fleet, let me tell you that the way how we look at fleet management or connected services as a tool is a customer retention tool. So we hope when the customer buys a SCANIA truck and they experience the end-to-end integration of the services and how we operate, they wouldn't switch from SCANIA. So I will take it a step above. Now, given the fact that the customer has multiple mixed fleet, we have not yet tried any such test cases in India on how do we manage the information across different brands. But I believe there are examples where we have successfully integrated fleet management across different brands in Europe. But I'm not sure if I can...
my question is, do you have a common platform which you probably want to integrate
in SCANIA
all the vehicle vendors and say that this is the common platform where the data would come in, right? So XML is for most of the web, it is XML. Oh. You can import XML from any standard and then convert it, right? So do you have something of that sort which would become a standard?
Nothing that I'm aware of. But if you're talking about whether a developer can develop it in SCANIA 1, I'm not sure. Because SCANIA 1 is still a very nascent concept even in Europe. So we have not really had many third-party applications being developed. Okay. The reason we opened it to third-party applications is purely, like I was telling him, to have a modular kind of experience. Mm-hmm. If in case an app developer feels the need for developing an app that can bring or add value to the customer, it should be possible. Sure. So that is the idea or thinking behind us having an integrated platform for SCANIA 1. And as to your data security, how do we manage the data security and the chunk of data that goes through? I believe there are, I'm not a computer guy, so I believe there are necessary systems that can protect people, that can protect data from being hacked. So I'm very sorry that I'm not able to provide you with a very accurate answer that you're looking for.
Sure, thank you.
I'll just add a word or two. So with regards to data security, right? So the usual stuff will always apply. So end to end, right from the device, totally depends on your client. Let's take two extreme examples. One person might not ask anything, right? Everything is in the clear and they don't really care. But the more interesting scenario is the other one, right? You have a corporate client and they want end-to-end security. So you would have to, you know, implement right from the device encryption, SSL, and then all the way down. There's one other thing with regards to data security, which is that especially if you're going with government tenders and contracts, they would require that the data be stored on a cloud which is hosted in India.
True.
Which means that, like, for example, Oracle Cloud still does not have a server in India. They're planning to do that, needless to say, but they don't right now. So if you're going for government tenders and something, that's one thing to keep in mind. But other than that, yeah, it's data security is can still be implemented, but
because if the data is not in your hands,
yeah,
it's as good as me saying that it's not secure, right? It's it's perspective from person to person.
So which is why, right? I mean, they would insist that a third party does complete penetration testing and OWASP testing and things like that to ensure that, you know, it's been certified by an independent third party to make sure that at least, you know, the data is secure from an objective third party.
Right.
With regards to the platform itself, there are several of them that will allow you to, you know, mix and match devices. And last time I attended like one of these IBM conferences, they mentioned that there were 150 companies building IoT platforms.
More than that.
So it's like, wow. I mean, and pretty much all of them will have to support multiple devices. And all of them will also have to support, and many of them will support MQTT. So if you stick to one of those, I think it should be fine.
Allow you to manage multiple.
Yeah.
Sure. Thank you. We do have provisions for pulling out API data.
Sure.
So that should allow us.
So that's another way to.
Sorry, Prakash, may I encourage that you. I believe the next speaker is ready. Sorry, if I can encourage you to pick up this conversation offline, that'll help. Right. So just a closing remark, and thank you very much for the perspectives, both from a connected services OEM point of view and also from the technology service provider point of view. Active participation from the audience as well. Again, Jagdish, Matiur, Anand, Prakash, thank you so much. Thank you. Arjun.